They are skillful.
Hello, art family, and thank you to all the new subscribers. Today we're going to take a look at another set from Golden Maple Brushes. They reached out to me and asked if I'd be interested in trying out any more of their brushes. And recently I've gotten into trying out calligraphy brushes from both China and other countries. And when I looked at their website, I noticed that they had some too. So I told them I was interested in these, and they were very generous to send me a box to demo here with today. These brushes, made from a variety of different companies, are typically not terribly expensive. And what I like about them is that they splay out really well and they point really well. I think typically the intention is more for the application of calligraphy. So they go thick to thin very well, but they also don't hold a hard point very well, or at least a soft point, which can be a tool. So if you're using something like a sable brush or something, you can get more of a kind of solid shape, where with these, because the bristles of the brush are a little less refined as something like sable, these are typically made with goat hair in some cases, or wolf hair, or synthetic in a lot of cases as well, but they're not quite as refined as those brushes, so you get a lot more of what I just showed there and what I'm going to experiment with here, which is something that I've really come to love about these kind of brushes, which is that they fall apart really well, which I think is a good thing. If you're wanting something that's very refined, you know, it takes a little bit more premeditation and thought, a little bit more deliberate application. But if you're looking to do things that have an organic kind of texture, like trees or, you know, rough patches of dirt or shrubs or things like that, these brushes are some of the best I've ever used, because they combine the fact that they are not quite as refined of a material as something like sable, but they also tend to be quite soft, so they don't really dig into the tooth of the paper. In this case, I'm using Arches 140 pound cold press paper, and you can see that when I lighten the stroke with the paintbrush, when I pull back a little bit with it, it starts to kind of crumble and fall apart in a really interesting way that I think really lends itself well to suggesting foliage. So instead of getting in there and trying to paint every, you know, leaf and branch, they do a great job of just allowing some of the water to, you know, you could tap it on a towel or something, get rid of some of the excess water. And then when you glide the brush across the surface, it tends to leave a lot of open spaces. So that might not be something that you love, but I find it to be a very interesting tool to use, especially when you're creating something that's organic. I think when you're trying to do organic things like trees, so to speak, there's a tendency for those things to, our brain kind of tries to fix them, so to speak, or make them a little bit too perfect. But when you're using a brush like this, it's kind of forcing your hand to let go of some of that control. It's kind of a constraint in that, you know, as you can see, as I'm trying to experiment here to see what kind of texture I can get with the side of the brush, it falls apart a little bit in a way that you can't quite control. So leaning into that, you can get some really interesting organic shapes that suggest distant foliage or distant mountains, that kind of thing. So that's something I've come to really like about them. And this particular pack comes with a variety of sizes. They don't really have a very large size, which I would have liked to have in a set. So the largest size in this is big enough to cover a lot of area, which is nice, but I tend to work with much bigger brushes. This is the smallest brush, which I would like into about a 2 or a 3 round. And I wanted to see how much it could carry with just one load of it. So I thought it did a great job, and all the brushes I thought were great, especially for the kind of brush that they are. The largest brush in this set I would like into about an 8 or a 10 maybe round. So it's a good size, and they carry a good amount of water, and they have soft bristles, so they do work very well for watercolor. So to demo with these brushes, I wanted to try doing a scene just using the brush completely, so not necessarily pre-drawing it with penciled contour lines, but experimenting with something I've been playing with lately, which is just going straight in with the watercolor. So I'm using the middle size of these brushes, which has a nice long point to it, and it's quite soft, so it holds a decent amount of water and it can carry pretty far. And I'm using pink here from Holbein. So this is watercolor Holbein pink. And I'm just going to draw in some of the basic shapes. I like to work this way because I think much more sculpturally about the thing I'm doing rather than getting kind of lost in the temptation of rendering a lot of detail. Especially when you're doing something like this fishing boat, I think it's easy to get carried away trying to draw all the detail. You can kind of run into a trap that way, because you can end up with a very well-drawn boat and then everything else sort of fall apart or be off. So what I want to do first before anything is close an eye and squint at the reference photo, and then I'm going to focus on the big shapes of what I'm looking at. In this case, we're working from a photograph, so it's a little bit handy in that we don't have to necessarily do, you know, measurement comparisons within the scene as you would if we were doing this on location. In this case, we kind of have the photograph that will lend itself to finding some of those points that we can triangulate the drawing. So I can look around for things like where the trees touch the edge of the photo or where the hill goes off. You know, I can line those things up before I start working on the shapes and triangulating where our broad shapes are. I started by wetting the whole page by spraying it with quite a bit of water just to get it all quite saturated. And now I'm using the largest brush in the set. And at first I was a little bit concerned. I'm not working very large here. This is 12 inches by, I think, 9 inches? 9 by 12? And working my way around now, and I was a little bit concerned about this stage using these fairly small brushes, because I think I've just gotten used to using quite large brushes. Typically I use like a 2-inch hake brush, but in this case I was wanting to do everything with this set just to see what I could do, and I actually was pretty impressed with how much travel I could get out, especially because I pre-wet the page, so it was going into, you know, a pre-dampened page, but I felt like I was able to move enough color to get a decent coverage. So I was taking that first step to just get rid of the white completely, because there's not really any bright white highlights in this image. You know, it's a diffuse light scene, and there's not really a big intense sunlight, so I'm knocking everything down. Everything has just this kind of tinge of cool to it, except for the boat, which sort of by comparison has a hint of warmth to it. So before we get into any of the details on it, I wanted to just go ahead and tinge the page with a slight stain, so to speak. And you know, initially it probably looked like it might have been too dark, but as we're working into it, you can see that first layer dries much, much lighter. Anytime you have water in the bristles and going on the page, it's going to dry much lighter, so you always want to keep that in mind. Because it's good to try to be concise when you're putting your shapes down. So I'm closing an eye, I'm squinting at the scene, and I'm trying to focus on not what the object is, but what's the broad general shape going on there. And then I'm trying to apply that value as close as I can. The hope is to set these pieces down kind of like a puzzle piece, and then it may not make sense necessarily if you were zoomed in really close, but if you step back from the scene, everything kind of comes into focus. That's sort of the hope and goal of this sketch, and sketches in the process that I tend to work in. So I'm just closing an eye and squinting, and I'm trying to place these shapes as concisely as possible. Most of these brushes are goat hair. Goat hair tends to be white. A lot of times you'll see the hake brushes or hake brushes, I'm not exactly sure how to say it. You'll see a lot of those tend to be with goat hair. It's a great bristle to work with watercolor. Once you get used to it, it's kind of like each different type of brush takes a little bit to get used to. I find with the goat hair brushes, they hold a lot of water and they're quite soft. So it's almost similar to a squirrel brush, but maybe not quite as absorbent of the water. But they tend to be very soft and they move very well across a page. I do find with goat hair brushes though, they tend to fall apart a little bit, but that I haven't really had that become a big issue as much as it's just something that happens every once in a while, although it didn't happen with these brushes. Maybe because they're smaller and I'm used to using much bigger brushes, so it's more noticeable, but they tend to, like the bristles tend to fall out as you go, like just one or two every once in a while. So sometimes I'll have a big wash with like a little bristle stuck in it you have to kind of knock off, but I've never had that become an issue and I've never had them completely fall apart either. But that is just something I've noticed and you might notice if you're using that kind of brush. Also, if you couldn't tell by the way I did the tree in the initial experimentation, I tend to be very, very rough with my materials, probably too rough. So there's that too, to keep in consideration. So that's going to be it of this look at the Golden Maple watercolor brush set with these kind of bamboo style goat and wolf brushes. I really liked the brushes and I think they are excellent for sketching especially. They make a great all-around brush. Well, thanks for watching. I'll see you in the next video. In the meantime, happy sketching.